Amen.
Thank you.
Good morning. What an honor to exalt his name together. Thank you for coming to Community Christian Church. You guys can have a seat. It is so good to be here together today. Community, a place to believe, belong, and become. And if this is your first time here at Community, welcome. We are so thankful that you chose to spend this morning with us. In the seat back right in front of you, you've got a Connect card. First-time guests, if you wouldn't mind filling that out. And at the end of the service, as you're going through the central lobby, on the right is a table called our Connecting Point table. Just take that card there. We've got a free gift waiting for you as a way of saying thank you for coming to worship with us today at Community. If you're watching online and you're brand new, you can text the word new to that number and we'll get that gift out to you in the mail. Now, for the rest of us, that Connect card, it's an awesome opportunity for you to let us know if there's any changes to your information. But on the bottom, that prayer request area, let us know how we can be praying for you. And on your way out, there's a giving box. Every single one of our lobbies has them. You can take that Connect card, just drop it in the giving box on your way out after service is done. So speaking of giving boxes, you can also take any tithes, any offerings that you brought with your Connect card. You can drop all of those right there on your way out. And for giving, for generosity, you can always go to communitycc.com/give. A lot of different ideas on how to live a generous life, on how you can give, knowing that your gift makes an eternal impact in somebody's life. Jesus gave his life for you, for me, on the cross, and he invites us as an act of worship to remember him. We do that every single Sunday during communion. Communion, just a time where we take a little piece of bread, a little cup of juice. We still have them in the back. If you didn't get those on the way in, feel free to get up now and you can grab those. But in just a bit, I'll pray. And after the prayer, we'll have some scripture on the screen. And as you take that bread, Jesus said it represents his body that was broken, that was sacrificed on the cross. And the juice represents his blood that was shed, the life that he gave for you and me so that we could be brought back to God. So communion's a time to worship as we remember Jesus and the cross. Let's pray together. We love you, God, and thank you for the sacrifice you made on the cross for every single one of us, God. So hear our prayers of repentance, of thanksgiving, of gratitude, God, as we continue worshiping you during communion. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All church, let's stand together as we confess our sins and worship Jesus.
Lord, I confess that I've been a criminal. I've stolen your breath and sang my own song. Lord, I confess. I'm falling.
Let's worship him as we sing, church.
Scarlet sins at a crimson cost. He nailed my debt to that old rugged cross. An empty slate at the empty grave. Thank God that stone was rolled away. Lord, I confess that I've been prodigal, made for your house, but walked my own road. Then
envision that, church, as we sing this together.
I see bright crimson robes draped over the ashes, a wide open tomb where there should be a casket. Children are singing and dancing and laughing. The Father is welcoming. This is our homecoming. Roses in bloom, they push up from the embers. The river addiction starts to break. Declare
shout Jesus from the mount, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. We believe in the name of Jesus. Can we proclaim that together?
How are you guys doing today? Yeah, great song. So glad that you're here. Want to welcome everyone who's in the room. Want to welcome those of you that are watching online. A lot of people on vacation now. Glad that you guys are tracking with us as well as we continue our teaching series called Seasons. I'm going to get to that in a moment. But I want you to raise your hand on this. How many of you watched Messi's debut on Friday night with Inter Miami? Raise your hand on that, okay? About 15. There were 7 in the first service. So, okay, there's more than that. I did. I watched it, and what an incredible end to the game. Now, I don't have Apple TV, so I wasn't able to listen to the broadcast. I think it was in English on Apple TV. I was on Univision, so it was all in Spanish. And so I learned a new word that I didn't know, and I've told you, I've been upfront with you guys. I wished I would have learned Spanish, you know, in the last 30 years that I've been down here, but I haven't. I do know a few words like hola, you know, I know that. And I know, you know, baño, you know, I know that word. That's in fumar, no fumar. I've seen that in elevators, so I know what that means. And then my favorite 2 Spanish words, though, as I've told you, are pollo tropical. Those are my favorite words, which translates into English as the best fast food on the planet. I'm pretty sure that's what that means. I'm not exactly sure, but I learned a new word on Friday night. Let me get ready for it. Go! Oh, I'm not sure, but I think it means goal. I'm not positive. Anyway, it was incredible. It really was. I mean, messy mania, messy magic has hit South Florida. How cool is this? And I played football back in ninth grade. I know very little a bit about it, but it was impressive. It really was. And so you're thinking, what does this have to do with the message? And the honest answer is not very much at all. I mean, absolutely nothing. I mean, today's message is the season of searching. And I was searching for something. I was searching for anything to start the message with. And that's all I got. So anyway, we're going to jump right on into the message today. So here we go. There's a verse coming on the screen. I want you to read this out loud with me today. It's a very important verse of scripture. We'll read it frequently here at Community. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. Here we go, out loud. And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. I gotta be honest with you, that verse used to confuse me. Because, I mean, it looks like that verse is promising that people who seek after God will find him. But I would see some people who apparently were seeking after God, but they didn't find him. They would say, I didn't find God. I don't think God is for me. And some of you've had family members or friends that went on a spiritual search, and you thought that they were going to find God, but to your disappointment, and you were puzzled when they didn't find God, because that verse says that they will, until I really looked at this verse again, and there's one word that really changes everything about this verse. Let's read this again, Hebrews 11, 6. And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. Earnestly, that's the key there, earnestly seek him. I've discovered that many people who think they're spiritually searching are really not all that earnest, to be honest with you, in their search for God. And so today, if you are in this spiritual searching phase of your life, I'm so glad that you're here. I am. But I hope that you'll use this time to clarify in your mind what it is you're really searching for, and if you are searching for it earnestly. God said in Jeremiah 29, 13, you will seek me and find me when you seek me with all of your heart. And so I think we all need to ask the question, what is it that we really hope to find when we find God? What is it that we hope that God will do in our life if we do find him? Now, just like the Israelites who had been waiting for years and years and years to be delivered from their oppression, from their pain in Egypt, many of us deep down are searching for a pain-reducing God. I mean, to be honest, that's really what we're searching for. In the past couple of weeks, we've been talking about the life of Moses. The first week, we talked about the season of waiting and how the Israelite people, they were waiting and waiting for a deliverer. And that was like before Moses was born. There's seasons of waiting. And then there was a season of woundedness when Moses did come, and he was rejected by the Israelite people, his people. He's rejected by the Egyptians. They wanted to kill him. And so that transitioned from a season of woundedness to a season in the wilderness. And Moses spent 40 years in the desert because he had a lot to learn, because God had a lot to do in his heart. And the truth is, when we're in the desert, you just want a pain-reducing God. I've been in the wilderness. And I want the pain to go away, so I understand that. Here's some actual responses from some comment cards at this wilderness area, Bridger Wilderness area in Wyoming. So people go on the trails and they do everything, and they fill out comment cards. And over the years, these are some of the best ones that were returned by actual people that visited this area. Please avoid building trails that go uphill. And that sounds pretty reasonable, doesn't it? You know, just downhill trails, that'd be nice. Trails need to be wider so people can walk while holding hands. Is that too much to ask? I mean, come on. And then too many bugs and leeches and spiders and spider webs. Please spray the wilderness to rid the areas of these pests. Reflectors need to be placed on trees every 50 feet so people can hike at night with flashlights. I don't think that's going to end very well if you do that. Too many rocks in the mountains. I guess you can have too much of a good thing. A McDonald's would be nice at the trailhead. And this is one, the last two are my favorite. The places where trails do not exist are not well marked. My favorite, though, is this one. escalators would help on steep uphill sections. Yes, they would. I would do more wilderness climbing if there were escalators for the hard parts. I mean, that's not unreasonable to ask. Now, today in our storyline, Moses, he returns to Egypt. He's fresh off of his desert experience after 40 years. He has this encounter, this experience with the living God at the burning bush. And so Moses is sent as the deliverer for God's people to go back to his place of failure, the place where he was rejected by his people, the Hebrew people, the Israelite people, and also rejected by the Egyptian people. But Moses goes back to lead them to the promised land. We're going to be in the book of Exodus today. If you want to have your Bible open or your Bible app, or if you want to follow along on the screen. So here we go. Exodus chapter 4, verse 29. Moses and Aaron brought together all the elders of the Israelites, and Aaron told them everything the Lord had said to Moses. And he also performed the signs before the people, the signs, the miracles, to validate the message and the messenger. And that's what a sign is. The book of Hebrews tells us it's to validate a sign, to validate the message and the messenger. Exodus chapter 4, verse 31, and they believed because of the miracles. And when they heard that the Lord was concerned about them and had seen their misery, they bowed down and they worshiped. So they produced these signs, these miracles, to validate that this message was actually from God. And it says they had seen their misery. The Israelites, they knew misery. They'd been beaten. They'd been oppressed. Their baby boys were thrown into the Nile River by Pharaoh and drowned. They knew misery. And so Moses comes back and he tells them that God has called him to go to Pharaoh and to demand the release of his people and say, let my people go. And God is behind this. And when they heard this and they saw the miracles, they bowed down and they worshiped, not Moses, they worshiped the God of heaven, the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and Joseph. And they bowed down and they worshiped him because God is going to reduce their pain. And that's why they worshiped him. I've discovered over the years that deep down, that's why many people are searching for God. That's what they're searching for someone to relieve their pain in life. And we all have pain. You know pain. I know pain. You probably have pain now. I have pain now in my life. Not everything is wonderful. A disappointment, a career setback, a divorce, a suicide of a family member or a loved one, the loss of a loved one, a murder, a dysfunctional relationship, an abusive relationship. And so many people in the midst of their pain say, I think that I need to find God. And so they start their search to have their pain reduced. Now I want you to hear me on this, because this message is challenging and it can certainly be misunderstood. I want you to know that you matter to God, that he cares deeply about you, that he's for you, that he's not against you, that he cares deeply about what you go through, and that God uses pain. God uses our pain to draw us to him. If I was to ask, how many of you in your conversion, in your decision to follow Jesus, that God used pain to do that? A lot of hands would be going up. A lot of hands would be going on. God does use pain. And God longs to walk with us through our pain, to be with us, to comfort us, to sustain us, to help us, to be with us in the storm. One of my favorite verses of scripture, Psalm 34, verse 18. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted. He rescues those who are crushed in spirit. So don't misunderstand what I'm about to say by what I say. God cares deeply about your pain, and he uses pain to draw you to him. But sometimes, if you were to peel back beneath the surface and ask a probing question, what is it that some people are really looking for? Are they really looking to find God, or are they really looking just to find a pain-reducing God? Are they searching for the true God as he is, or simply looking for a quick fix, an instant cure, a fast remedy to their pain? Friends, God knows the difference. He wants more than that. He's not fooled when we say we're searching for him when we're really just searching for a Valium dispensing God to relieve us of our pain. God's kind of like the game warden who saw a guy fishing one day down by the river. It was one day after the fishing season had ended. He was fishing illegally, and the game warden saw him, so he's walking down kind of that path toward the river, and the guy happens to hear something. He looks back, and the game warden's wearing this green shirt, and he recognizes it. He knows that he's in trouble, so he takes his fishing rod, it has some worms on it, and he just starts, rather than just setting it out there, he starts moving the fishing rod back and forth like this, back and forth, and the game warden comes up. He goes, "What in the world are you doing?" He said, "I'm just trying to teach these worms how to swim. That's what I'm doing." He wasn't fooled. God isn't fooled. We don't fool God with our motives for a second. Now, let me say this, and I hope that this doesn't disconnect you. I didn't say it in the last service. I haven't fully processed whether this is good to insert now or not, because I just don't want you to mishear what I'm saying. I think God, we can find the true God, even when our motives are mixed. God can work, because the truth of the matter is, seldom are our motives 100% pure. I'm just telling you that. Blessed are the pure in heart. We're not 100% pure. We have all kinds of things. We don't even know what we're thinking. I was far from God all through high school. In a philosophy class my freshman year, I had to answer the question, what is the purpose and the meaning of life? That question kind of rocked me. I decided a year later that I would go to a Christian college, mostly to find out, not to be a pastor, but to find out, do I believe this? And so I went on a search. I went on a quest for the truth. And I've told you that story before. But there's another layer about my motivations. There was a girl in Orlando. And she said, "Don't come down here because I'm down here." I go, "I'm not. I'm on this quest." 2 weeks later, she broke up with me. And the truth is, I was okay with that. But I had mixed motives. And going. They weren't 100% pure. But we need to make sure that at least part of our motives are trying to find the true God and not just relief from our pain. So I hope that's helpful as we go through this, because I want this to be a challenge for you, but not a disconnect for you. All right, I'll evaluate whether that was a good 2 minutes or not later. It's hard to know in the moment. It's not in the notes. They're back there going, "Scott's going off script again. That's never good, never good." So the Israelites, they bowed down and they worshiped the God who they believe is about to reduce their pain. Exodus 5:1, afterward, Moses and Aaron went to the Pharaoh and said, "This is what the Lord, the God of Israel says. Let my people go so that they may hold a festival to me in the desert." Pharaoh said, "Who is the Lord that I should obey him and let Israel go? I do not know the Lord, and I will not let Israel go." Now, as I'm reading that, I'm thinking, watch out, Pharaoh. You're in some deep weeds here, pal. You say another thing, it might not end up very well for you. Now, Pharaoh's response to this request was not what they had expected. It certainly was not what they hoped. Now, Pharaoh not only refuses to let them go, but Pharaoh, he doubles down on their pain. And in Exodus 5, it continues with these words. That same day, Pharaoh gave this order to the slave drivers and foremen in charge of the people. "You're no longer to supply the people with straw for making bricks. Let them go and gather their own straw, but require them to make the same number of bricks as before. Don't reduce the quota. They're lazy. That's why they're crying out, 'Let's go and sacrifice to our God.' Make the work harder for the men so they keep working and they pay no attention to the lies." Now, this is not what the Israelites had hoped to hear. Moses goes to them after they've bowed down and they've worshiped God because God is going to reduce their pain, and he tells them that their pain is only going to increase in what's happening. And we read in verse 20, they found Moses and they found Aaron, and they said, "May the Lord look upon you and judge you. You've made us a stench to Pharaoh and his officials and put a sword in their hand to kill us." Not happy at all with Moses and Aaron. And so Moses goes to God. He says, God, what is it that you want me to do? I mean, you've heard their cry. You saw their pain. You want to relieve that, but it's doubled now. What do you want me to tell them? I want you to go back, and I want you to reassure them that I have seen their pain. I have heard their cries. I understand their misery. Just let them know that I will deliver them. Verse 9, Moses reported this to the Israelites, but they did not listen to him because of their discouragement and cruel bondage. Now, friends, let me ask, where are the people who moments ago were bowing down and worshiping God? Where did they go? Just like some people do sometimes when they discovered that God wasn't going to do all that they wanted him to do to reduce the pain that they were in, and it didn't play out exactly the way that they had hoped. They don't want to listen anymore. I see this happen sometimes, and instead of people really admitting, they kind of have mixed motives in all of this. They camouflage their lack of earnestness by saying things like, well, I tried to seek after God, but I didn't find him. God may be good for you, but he's not really for me. Now, why didn't it not happen for them? And it goes back to that key word of earnestly. They didn't search earnestly. Friends, I can't help but wonder, maybe deep down, if some of us were to be honest with ourselves, really what we're searching for is a Valium dispensing God. And that's what we want. And really don't want anything more than that. We just wanted God to come in and step in and reduce our pain. And then when the pain is gone, we say, thank you, God. I'll see you again next crisis. And God doesn't want that. I mean, he's able to do that. But that's not really seeking him earnestly. God wants to be in a relationship with us. He wants to walk with us. He wants to go with us through the storm, through the pain, that the pain drives us not to have our pain reduced, but it drives us to him, that he is enough, that he is the one that we rely on. The pain draws us to him, not just a desire to use him to reduce our pain. And there is a difference. Now, there's another group of people who go through a season of searching. We see that in this section of scripture. And they're like Pharaoh. They're like the king. And many people are searching simply for a prosperity-producing God. That's what they want, just a prosperity-producing God. Heard about a man named George who married a very wealthy woman. And when they moved into their brand new house, 10,000 square feet, she took every opportunity that she could to remind George that most of the money in their family was hers. George, I just want you to know that we wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for my money. The new furniture was delivered, and she said, George, if it wasn't for my money, this beautiful new furniture wouldn't be here. George, if it wasn't for my money, that 120-inch 4K TV, it wouldn't be here. George, those Lamborghinis that are out front on the circular driveway, if it wasn't for my money, they wouldn't be here. George could take it no longer. He said, look, I hate to break it to you, but if it wasn't for your money, I wouldn't be here. We could kind of sense that one coming, but it's still funny. It was one of those, you kind of know where it's going. If some people were just honest with themselves, they would say, if it wasn't for what God could do for me, well, yeah. I don't think I'd really be that interested if it wasn't for what he could do for me. And we're going to see in a few moments that Pharaoh's only interest in God was to the extent that God could help him, that God could make him successful, that God could advance his empire. And Pharaoh's interested in that, but really not anything else. And some of us, maybe, some people are searching for a prosperity-producing God, a God who just gives us what we want. It's the young executive looking for help from God for a promotion. It's the professional athlete praying to God for protection, but also selection to the Pro Bowl would be nice too. It's a struggling student looking to God for good grades. It's the entrepreneur looking to God for help with their business. It's the candidate who's looking for votes. Friends, the common thread in all of these stories is someone seeking for God's supernatural voltage to help make their dream a reality. Let me say this. You matter to God. He cares deeply about you. Jesus said, I have come that you might have life, life in all of its fullness. So he wants you to have the fullness of life, the abundance of life, the abundance of life. But he wants you to be in a relationship with him. He wants to be with you. He said, I'll never leave you. I'm not going to abandon you. Other people may. I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I will be with you to the end of the age. And we can be thankful for that. But if all we want is his supernatural voltage to come down and just kind of empower our goals, then it's like, huh, I see through that. I want a lot more than that. He wants us. Moses goes before Pharaoh and he says in Exodus 5 verse 1, this is what the Lord, the God of Israel says, let my people go. Is that so? That's my Pharaoh impression, I'm sorry. But anyway. And who is the Lord that I should listen to him and let Israel go? I don't know the Lord, and I will not let Israel go. And I can imagine Moses with his brother Aaron. This is not going the way we had hoped. Pharaoh doesn't know God. He's not interested in God at all. Especially if that means that if he knows this God, he's gonna lose his free labor force that's building his empire. The Israelite slaves. Pharaoh is only interested in God if he will advance his own prosperity. Moses regroups and he goes back to Pharaoh a second time. Yet Pharaoh's heart became hard and he would not listen to them just as the Lord had said. So Pharaoh, he just completely just hardens his heart, refuses to listen. Pharaoh claims in that time to be divinity. Pharaoh claimed to be a god. And so the God of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph, the Yahweh God, the God of the Old Testament, the God of today, Jesus the same yesterday, today, and forever. This God, he shows up in power. And it's one of the most dramatic sections of scripture in all of the Bible when God sends 9 object lessons to Pharaoh. We're gonna see who's God and who's not God. 9 chances for Pharaoh to say, okay, I give up, I get it. I'm not God, I'm just a man, you're God and I'm not. 9 different chances to listen to God and to soften his heart toward God. Now, I think this is interesting. The plagues that God sent upon Egypt, it was God's way of judging the Egyptian gods. Every single plague was a response to, was an undermining of one of the Egyptian gods. They were mocking the Egyptian gods. They were communicating that these are false gods, that they are futile gods, and that God is the God of all. And that's what was happening with these specific plagues. Every one was a response to one of the Egyptian gods. Pharaoh's heart was hard. So God said, okay, Pharaoh, let the plagues begin. And first, God turned all the water in the Nile River to blood. All the fish died. The smell was horrendous. Blood was everywhere. Pharaoh's heart, still hard. Plague number 2, God sent a plague of frogs. Now, these weren't cute little Kermit-type frogs. These were nasty, ugly frogs that were everywhere, not just outside in the fields. They were inside the houses, in their bathrooms. They were in their kitchen and their microwaves. I mean, they were everywhere that they could be found. Now there's a plague of gnats, which is plague number 3. Tiny little stinging insects, maybe no-see-ums like we have here, penetrating your nostrils and your ears and your eyes, drive you crazy. Plague 3. Plague 4, a plague of flies. There were flies in every bowl of soup in Egypt. You know what it's like when you go on a picnic. People go out and they play. They leave all the food on the table, the picnic table. They come back, and you're just swarmed with flies. That was plague number 4. Now, the interesting thing about plague number 4 is this is the first plague that was exclusively for the Egyptians. Plagues 1, 2, and 3 affected the Egyptians and the Israelites. Plagues 4 through 10 just affected the Egyptians. 5th plague, livestock epidemic. All the livestock of the Egyptians died, not any of the livestock of the Israelite people, God's people. It was followed by a plague of boils. Festering boils broke out over all the people, all the animals, everywhere. Pharaoh's heart still remained hard. Plague number 7 was a plague of hail. I mean, all hell broke loose. It was everywhere. It's according to the Bible. I've read it that way. And it was the worst storm in the history of Egypt. The people and the animals, the crops, they were just stripped by the hail. And what was left after that, it was the eighth plague was locust. And locusts were everywhere. And they just devoured the swarm of anything that was left after the hail. Now, interestingly, it's at this point that Pharaoh does an interesting thing. It appears at this point that his heart is softening. He's under pressure. It's pain. He's opening up possibly to God. And we read in Exodus 10, verse 16, Pharaoh quickly summoned Moses and Aaron and said, I've sinned against the Lord your God and against you. Now forgive my sin once more and pray to the Lord your God to take this daily plague away from me, deadly plague away from me. Now, it appears that Pharaoh is spiritually searching. He calls for Moses. He calls for Aaron. He confesses his sin. He asks for prayer. But it's not about a broken heart. It's about his kingdom is being threatened by all these plagues. And it's about it still advancing his own prosperity. Notice in verse 20 of Exodus 10, but he did not let the people go. It was still about him and his kingdom. That led to the ninth plague, which is the plague of darkness. Now, on the surface, that's probably the easiest plague of all. I mean, it just get dark. I mean, no bugs, not all the mess, not blood, it's just dark. Probably one of the worst plagues. Dark as dark could be for 3 days. Have you ever been in a cave, you know, deep in the earth where there's no light, and part of the cave experience is they turn out the lights? It gets freaky. It gets eerie. I mean, you can't even see your hand in front of you. The Bible says it was darkness so dark that it was darkness that you could feel, and it was eerie. Now, for the Israelites, same light of the day and no change for them. Now, friends, Pharaoh has had 9 different chances to soften his heart toward God, but this prosperity-producing agenda that he had kept getting in the way, and it happens all the time. People develop their goals and their agendas and their dreams and their visions and say, okay, God, this is my will. I want you to bring your power to supercharge my dream, my future. Instead, what God wants us to say, I love you. You matter to me. I gave you my son to die for you. Jesus said, I've come that you might have life in all of its fullness. But the question that you should be asking is, God, what do you want me to do? Some people want God's power, but not God's will. And Jesus wants us to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And the other things will be added to us, Matthew 6:33. And so we follow him because that's what he calls us to do. And when a prosperity-producing person realizes that God's not going to give them everything the way that they wished that he would have, they often will stop their search and they'll say, God didn't do for me what I wanted him to do, so I'm done. Jesus reminded prosperity seekers one time, Mark chapter 8, verse 36, how do you benefit if you gain the whole world but you lose your own soul in the process? Now again, friends, I know that this is hard because we don't have 100% pure motives on anything. I wish I would have said that last service. But what's our primary motivation? What's really driving us? Is it just volume for our pain, and that's really all we want? Or is it just voltage for our goals, and that's all we want? If we're searching earnestly, then we'll be about finding the true God, the true God. And that's what he wants. He wants to step into our pain. He wants to lead us in our lives. Those who are earnest about finding the true God and accepting God on his terms and his way, those are the ones who really find him. Now, after 9 plagues, Pharaoh would still not surrender. Pharaoh was hard-hearted and hard-headed. I mean, after 9 kind of object lessons, 9 objects, opportunities, he still didn't change. And his stubborn, hard heart led to the most tragic plague of all. Pharaoh was warned about this plague. He was told in advance that it would happen. He had an opportunity to prevent it, and yet he didn't. He refused to budge. Exodus 12, verse 21. Then Moses called for the leaders of Israel and said, "Tell each of your families to slaughter the lamb that they've set apart for the Passover. For the Lord will pass through the land and strike down the Egyptians. But when he sees the blood on the top and the sides of the doorframe, the Lord will pass over your home. He will not permit the destroyer to enter and strike down your firstborn." Now, friends, there are a couple of lessons from the Israelites that I think we can learn about finding the true God. Now, first of all, it's a side lesson, but it's an important one. They blew their search earlier. They really did. But this time, they get it right. That's really good news for me. Why? Because God gives us multiple chances. He's given Pharaoh at least 9 chances. And the Israelite people, they get it right this next time. I didn't get it right. God gave me multiple chances, and I'm thankful for that. Lesson number one in finding the true God: salvation comes through the blood of the Lamb, so trust him. Salvation comes through the blood of the Lamb, so trust him. Let's say that out loud together. Salvation comes through the blood of the Lamb, so trust him. One more time, really good and loud, really strong. Salvation comes through the blood of the Lamb, so trust him. You know, there's this very interesting caveat that Moses gives to the children of Israel about getting a lamb and sacrificing it and putting the blood on the doorpost, and you might miss it. Moses says in Exodus 12 that they were to find a lamb on the 10th day of the month, and then they were to sacrifice and kill the lamb on the 14th day of the month, 4 days later. Why 4 days? I think it was because God wanted them to have the lamb in the house for 4 days. God wanted the children and the family to see that lamb and to play with that lamb and feed that lamb and maybe even give it a little name, and it becomes a little pet to them. Is God sadistic? No, not at all. It's another object lesson. Forgiveness of sins involved sacrifice. And that sacrifice is real and it's personal. It's painful. I think God wanted them to understand that forgiveness of sin always involves a sacrifice. I mean, can't you see a little 8-year-old boy, Israelite boy in Egypt, and dad's picking up the lamb and he's taking it to sacrifice, and the little boy figures out what's going on, and in his horror, he goes, Dad, what are you doing? Not fluffy. And dad just has tears in his eyes. It's his son. It's the lamb, or it's you. I think God wanted us to understand the sacrifice for sin is not an impersonal thing. It's a painful sacrifice. The Bible says in Exodus 12, 28, so the people of Israel did just as the Lord had commanded through Moses and Aaron. And they put blood on the doorpost, and they put it on top of the door. And that night, the angel, the death angel, the destroyer, passed over every home, the Passover. And that's the Passover feast that we talk about today. And there's weeping in Egypt among the Egyptian people, especially the Egyptian moms. There was wailing in the streets. The Bible says, like it had never been heard before or since, because they lost their firstborn sons. But not in the Israelite homes. You see, those who trusted in the blood of the Lamb were saved. Those who trusted in the blood of the Lamb were spared. And God was sending a signal to all people for all generations that our salvation would come through the blood of a lamb. And we need to trust him. The Bible makes it clear, friends, that the only way that spiritual seekers like you and me can have forgiveness of sins is through the blood of Jesus Christ, and we need to trust him. The Bible is communicating from the very beginning of the Bible to the final pages of the Bible that Jesus is the Lamb of God who would take away the sins of the world. Isaiah the prophet, 700 years before Jesus stepped on planet Earth, he foretold what would happen to the Messiah. Let's read these words out loud. We're gonna read quite a few verses, just short verses. Let's read this. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter. John the Baptist, when he saw Jesus coming to him one day, John had an interesting way of referring to his cousin Jesus. He said, let's read it out loud. Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. The Apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7, let's read, for Christ our Passover Lamb has been sacrificed. The Apostle Peter wrote in 1 Peter 1:19, let's read, he paid for you with the precious lifeblood of Christ, the sinless, spotless Lamb of God. And then the Apostle John, in the book of Revelation, he talks about Jesus as the Lamb of God in Revelation chapter 5, verse 12. Let's read this out loud. Good and strong today, friends. Here we go. In a loud voice they sang, worthy is the Lamb who was slain, to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Forgiveness of sins comes from Jesus, the Lamb of God, who paid the penalty for our sins. And God was signaling to all people for all time that hope could be had through the sacrifice of a lamb. And Jesus is our lamb. Now, once you find the true God, and so many of you have, there's a second lesson that we need to learn about finding the true God, and is that God leads us to new places, so follow him. God leads us to new places, so follow him. Let's read that out loud together. God leads us to new places, so follow him. And we're gonna get into this more next week with the Exodus, and we're gonna see how God led his people to new places and how we are to follow him. I'm looking forward to next week's message. But when this plague hit, it devastated Pharaoh. It broke him. It cost him the life of his son. Chapter 12, verse 31. Pharaoh sent for Moses and Aaron during the night. Leave us, he cried. Go away, all of you. Go and serve the Lord as you have requested. He's broken. Take your flocks and herds and be gone. Go. But give me a blessing as you leave. Still, this prosperity seeking Pharaoh, not fully broken. So the Israelites, they already have their sandals on, they have their bags packed, and nearly 2 million of them have been waiting for this day for 430 years, and now the day is here. And they follow God, they follow him wherever he leads. Now, the Bible teaches us that God starts with us where we are, but he doesn't leave us where we are. He wants to take us to new places. Finding the true God means that we start walking in his direction. We start living life his way. It's, you know, three steps forward, two steps back, two steps forward, five steps back. I mean, it's a journey. It's an imperfect and messy journey. We start living his way. We start following his leading. We start loving with his heart, and we just do this. And we're not just looking for a reduction of our pain or prosperity. We're looking for him. We're seeking him. And if you want to find the true God, you must earnestly search for him with all of your heart. Again, God said in Jeremiah 29:13, you'll seek me and you'll find me when you seek me with all of your heart. Now, sometimes we could smoke screen this. Again, our motives are never 100% pure, but we can smoke screen it and say, I'm really searching, but our primary motive is we're just trying to delay. We're just trying to like lead people on. We have this search with intellectual doubts, and we're not honest doubters, we're dishonest doubters. I've met dishonest doubters before. And well, is there really a God? And is there really sin that separates man from God? And is there really man? And is there really is? And I mean, they're kind of just dishonest doubters. And they believe their doubts. I mean, they have as strong of a belief in their doubts as we might believe our faith. I just want to encourage you, look, if you are a person that has genuine questions, then I want to let you know, you are so very welcome here. That was me when I went to Christian college after a philosophy class as a freshman. I went down there to find out if it's true and for a girl. And so anyway, I went down there. Not 100% pure motives. But is your primary motive the truth, or is it just to say that you're searching? So rather than just believing your doubts, doubt your doubts. And I say this all the time to people. This is a place that you're welcome here. If you have questions, and we want to be merciful to those who doubt, the Bible says in Jude 1:22. Maybe that's not your thing. Maybe, you know, you're not really wanting to search for God because you're just a rebel. You want to do life on your terms. Hey, I'm going to do life my way, my terms. Nobody tells me what to do. I love Dr. Phil's line. How's that working out for you? How's that working out? Jesus said, I've come that you might have life in all of its fullness. I'm doing life on my terms and my way. How's that working out for you? He wants the best for you. He really does. Maybe you just want to play hardball about it. Say, I think God's bluffing on this whole Jesus is the only way to heaven. God, you don't scare me. Be careful with that. Or you can just bet that one day on the day of judgment, you're going to be able to cut a deal with God, wheel and deal like you've been able to pull off throughout your life. Most people, though, it's not that. It's not like this, you know, like in-your-face defiance to God. I mean, God still loves you if you do that. And he may really use pain to bring you to him. But I think most people, it's not that, it's this. You know, I got a lot going on right now. I mean, I've been thinking about it, but I don't have really time to process all this. I don't have time to make it. I'm gonna back burner this thing. I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna do it one day, but just not today. And I get that. But Pharaoh reminds us that you can wait too long. You can wait too long. One of the most intriguing passages of the Bible, and that's a big statement, but I love what I'm about to tell you. It's in this section of scripture during the plagues. It was during the plague of frogs, and it was just the second plague. It was before things started to get even worse between Moses and Pharaoh. It was the second plague, and that plague affected the Israelite people as well as the Hebrew people. And so Pharaoh goes, wow, I want it to end. I want it to end. Maybe this is it. And he summons Moses, said, Moses, can you please stop this frog plague from happening? And Moses goes, yeah, well, stop it. I'm going to give you the honor of determining when. You just tell me when you want the frog plague to stop, and that's when it'll stop. Pharaoh goes, huh, how about tomorrow? You think about that. You got frogs everywhere. Frogs in your pants, frogs in your shirts, frogs everywhere. I mean, it's miserable, frogs everywhere. And he says, tomorrow. I would have said, Moses, do you have a time machine? How about yesterday or the day before yesterday? Can you go back? Because these frogs are miserable. I don't want to see another frog for the rest of my life. If you don't have a time machine, if you can't go back in time right now, this second, this nanosecond, not another second. I think so. That's what most of us would probably say, some version of that, but not Pharaoh. Tomorrow, you think about this. Moses, in his conversation with Pharaoh's response, tomorrow, and Pharaoh said, tomorrow, and Moses, and Pharaoh spent one more night with the frogs. He spent one more night with the frogs than he had to. It could have been over, but he says, tomorrow. And he spent one more night with the frogs. Friends, for some of you, you've been on a spiritual search for a long time, and you've been close to making this decision to follow Jesus, and then you back off, you pull away, you delay. And Pharaoh tells us that you can wait too long. Don't spend one more night with the frogs. Don't harden your heart. God wants to be your deliverer. Jesus came to be your great deliverer from your sin by the blood of the Lamb. He wants to lead you into new places. Today is another chance. And make today that day. Jeremiah 29:11, I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. Hear it again. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Jesus, I've come that you might have life in all of its fullness, but it's on my terms and doing life my way. You will seek me and you will find me when you seek me with all of your heart. So I just have to ask you, what is it you're searching for? Are you searching for volume for your pain or voltage for your goals? Are you searching for the true God? Because he wants to have this relationship with you. And he'll move in your storm. He'll move in your pain, and he'll move in your life too. He wants to do that. He wants more than just this outside force. He wants to be inside of us. I just want to ask if you just go ahead and bow your head right now where you're at. I know that some of you are on a search in your life, a spiritual search, a search for God. Some of you are even surprised to find yourself searching right now. If somebody would have told you a year ago that you'd be here in a church, you'd kind of chuckle a little bit, not me, but here you are, and maybe you're even a little afraid of what's going on. how God seems to be nudging and prompting you and calling you, but you're more afraid not to make this search. So I just want to ask you, what is it that you are really searching for? Father, I thank you for opening up the doors to salvation every single week here at Community. For all who earnestly seek you through the blood of the Lamb, Christ Jesus, our Savior and our hope. Father, I pray for those who have not yet responded that today, another chance, today would be their day, that they'd just decide that they're not gonna put it off anymore, that at the end of the service, in just a moment after the service is over, they'll come and they'll talk to someone about making this most important spiritual decision. Father, I pray that they'll sense through your Spirit right now that you're calling them, you're prompting them, yes, today is the day, so come on. Father, for those of us who've already made that decision, I pray that we would follow you. Whatever that means, whatever that looks like, that God, that we love you, not for what you can do for us, but we love you and we're grateful to you. And Father, I thank you that in the midst of our mess, in the midst of even mixed motives, God, that we are trying to find our way. We're trying to follow you. We're trying to honor you. So God, I pray that you would move through our lives and you'd lead us through your Spirit. Father, we pray all this in Jesus' name. For his sake today, we pray, amen.
Thank you, Pastor Scott. Today is the day. Some of you guys need to make that decision. You want to, right? Just a little bit. The end of the service will be down here in front. We'd love nothing more than to talk with you and pray with you, help you take that step towards Jesus and his kingdom. No more frogs. No more wasted days. Today can be that day. If you're watching online, you can text the word pray to this number. We'll follow up with you. We'll pray with you here in person as well. Don't wait. On your way out today in the central lobby, you'll notice at the center column, community impact display. Going to be Saturday, August 12th, one of our favorite events we do here. Opportunity for you to get together with some folks and just serve like Jesus. Grab that packet. You can go to communitycc.com/outreach. See all the different opportunities, partners that we have here in South Florida, ways to make a difference. And of course, it's Summer Nights at Community, continues tonight, Fiesta Night. We've got nachos, we've got some live music. It's happening immediately following the 6 p.m. service inside the next-gen air-conditioned building next door. So come on back, enjoy some nachos, some live music. We're going to have a great time tonight after the 6 p.m. service. We hope you have a fantastic week serving Jesus and his kingdom. Thanks again for coming. Take care, everybody.